نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطيع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار أما بعد To present my brothers and sisters in al-Islam, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, always before he spoke about anything, he always used to say, indeed, the best speech is the book of Allah, and the best guidance is the guidance of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the ways of all affairs are newly invented matters in the religion. And every newly invented matter in the religion is misguidance. And every misguidance leads to the hellfire. My brothers and sisters, our discourse today with regard to our khutbah is what is happening in the contemporary world as we know it today. We'll be talking about the teaching of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As we know, majority of the people in the world, they are unaware of the reality of who Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was. As a consequence of that, they abuse him, they mock him, they do all sorts with regard to him, because to their, in their world, there is nothing sacred. So they claim. However, my brothers and sisters, some of these individuals, they are well positioned. They know very well why they are doing what they are doing. But for the majority of the people, the masses, they have no clue. They just go along with what the media say. They just follow what the media say. Muhammad is this, they will just accept that. And this is not something new. This has happened even during the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Those in position, they always, in order to try to prevent people from following the prophets, they will mock and do all sorts, as we know from the seerah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In our case, there is no any difference. And I didn't want to dwell too much into this because this is a well-known fact. My discourse, I wanted to center it with regard to how we respond to what these people are doing. Because for any Muslim, we'll have to be offended seeing what these people they are doing. And if you are not offended, there is something wrong with your iman. Definitely, there is something wrong with your iman. But the question is, how do we respond to what they are doing? This is issue number one. Number two, why are they doing what they are doing? Because it's clear, for previous prophets, or during the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the kuffar, they tried all sorts of means in order to make sure that people didn't follow Muhammad. It didn't work. So the only thing they could do was to tell lies. And this can be said partly in our case. They are trying to make sure that the masses, they don't realize the reality of Islam so that they embrace it. In order to do that is to mock and portray the picture which is not in the picture. However, my brothers and sisters, there is an element of truth in what they are saying. You want to see the chaos in the world? Just go in the Muslim world. This is a fact. We have to be mature and grown up enough to face up the reality which we are in. This didn't happen just like that. We have given them a whip to whip us with. So my brothers and sisters, what is happening today in front of our eyes, it should be a wake-up call and realize the notions we are holding about our Prophet and Islam in general, they are not the correct things. We should try and change. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was sent by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not only for the Muslims. The Muslims, yes, they've decided to accept him. We have accepted him as a prophet. The kuffar or the non-Muslims, they have denied him, but he's still their messenger. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran, Ya ayyuhan nas, inni rasulullah ilaykum jami'a. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying, oh people, I am a messenger to you all. Those who have accepted me, they are Muslims. And those who rejected, they are non-Muslims. So it is imperative for us as Muslims to make sure that we share the teachings, the personality of this great man, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because if we do that, whatever we are seeing today happening, believe me, it's not going to be happening the way it's happening. They may not become Muslims, but definitely they won't abuse him. Of course, those who are after power, position, and fame, they'll continue to do what they are doing. I'm talking about the masses here. As the brother just gave us a story yesterday, he's a taxi driver. He said he picked up a passenger. He looked a Caucasian, it's an Englishman, 20, 25, and realizing the brother was a Muslim, he started talking to him. He said, you know, I heard about Muhammad, but I never really paid much attention about him until all this cartoon business came about. So I decided to look into him. I was glued on my computer from yesterday night until this morning at 7. And I found out, actually, this individual was a great personality. It's not what they are saying or what they are trying to bring about with regard to him, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So my brothers and sisters, the point here is, we need to go out there and let the people know who Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ لِمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُو اللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمَ الْآخِرِ وَذَكَرَ اللَّهُ كَثِيرًا. In the message of Allah, there is a great example for you to follow, for those who remembers Allah much, and those who are looking forward for the day of judgment. There is a great example for us to follow in him. We as Muslims, what we've done, we are Muhammad when we are in the masjid. When it comes to prayer, your hands should be on the chest. Should be on the chest, that's the sunnah. It has to be foot to foot. But when we are out there, we are, I don't know who we are. In here, when it comes to rituals, we do everything according to the sunnah. In our other businesses, we are something else. My brothers and sisters, Islam is a set of beliefs that is being displayed in a set of rituals that will impact the character of that particular individual. And this change in character is displayed in dealings with other people. In short, your prayer, your fasting, your hajj should make sure that will change you to become a different individual in terms of your character. How was I before last Ramadan? Have I changed or I'm worse than the way I was before the Ramadan? Therefore, my brothers and sisters, Muslims have to go beyond the rituals and internalize Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam morals, character, totally and comprehensively. They have to take Muhammad out of the masjid. They need to be Muhammad as fathers, as husbands, in their business dealings, as daughters and mothers, We need to be Muhammad in our lives in general. And if we do this, the rest will be automatic. Believe you and me. This happened in the past. It is well known. A lot of people became Muslims during the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It's not because someone was had a dawah table out there giving them leaflets. They observed the Muslims. Automatically themselves, they say, we want to be with them. Someone will come and say, are you the Prophet? Yes, I am the Prophet. And he will take a shahad. Why? Because they see. For this guy to claim he's a prophet is definitely a prophet. Why? Because of the way he is. My brothers and sisters, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was a father, like many of us in here. His daughter Fatima will go and visit him. The Prophet will stand up, kiss his daughter in the forehead, and he will let her sit where he was sitting. He will let her sit where he was sitting. Most of the time, my brothers and sisters, we demand our rights without thinking of our obligations. We want things to be handed over to us. We want people or our kids, in most cases, to respect us without thinking, are we being respectful to them, and vice versa. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in the prayer, he will hear a child crying. He will hasten up the prayer because he didn't want the mother to be under stress because of the child crying. He was truly a walking mercy to all mankind, not only to the Muslims, as was said previously. He was not about me, myself, and I. This wasn't Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. As a husband, we all know Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to mend his own clothes. He helped in the house with house chores. He cleaned, he cooked. To an extent where they would say, no, leave it, we'll do it. He said, no, I want to be helping. Can't I give you a bit of my time? This is what it was. But in our case, our wives, they are slaves and we are masters. She says she should do what I say, in our case. But this is not Islam, my brothers and sisters. And we want to show this to these people. Look, Islam is not what the media is portraying. We can claim to say that the media is so powerful, they own all the channels. But all of us in here, we are neighbors. And most of our neighbors, they are non-Muslims. There is no one who is standing between you and them in terms of letting them know what Islam is all about. Actually, you in person is more effective than the TV. The TV will say whatever he's saying, they'll say, no, I have a neighbor who is a good human being, very helpful. There is no way who will do what you are saying. That can't be the case. How many of us are we in the world today? To be on the safe side, we'll say what? 1.5 or 1.6 billion people, they are Muslims. Can you imagine all of us being good Muslims, the impact that is going to have to the entire human population on the earth today? Today, my brothers and sisters, our sisters particularly, they have been reduced into three C's using Imam Irshad's words: cooking, cleaning, and cohibition. This is not Islam, my brothers and sisters. We want to bring Islam as it was practiced by Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and as a result, those who are smearing campaign with regard to making people afraid of Muslims and Islam, they'll be defeated. Allah is the promise of Allah. He is always going to be with us as long as we obey him and his Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So this in itself is an indication of our situation as Muslims in general. What we are in terms of our iman. However, my brothers and sisters, when it comes to Islam and women, when we look to the way the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam dealt with his wives, how the Sahaba radhiallahu anhum dealt with their wives, it's clear Islam is not what is being portrayed. However, for some reason, there is this rigidity, uncalled for, where Islam is presented in the harshest of manners, where everything to do with women is seen as punishment and not liberation. At the time when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was commissioned, people used to bury their daughters alive. When someone gets the news, your wife gave birth to a baby girl, that was the end of the world. But after Islam, as Umar is recalling here, he said, the best of you are those who are best to their wife. This is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says. Umar said, before Islam, women were nothing, but in Islam, women are the reference point to judge the nobility of a man. You want to know, is he a man or a chicken? You see the way he's dealing with his wife. As a neighbor, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam say, none of you, you become true believers until you love for your brother what you love for yourself. You can't be a believer until you love for your brother what you love for yourself. And Imam Nawawi commented in this hadith. He said, number one, this hadith here, this is the minimum, the bare level a Muslim should possess. But if you want to go to the maximum, is that you should prefer for your brother more than you prefer for yourself. You want a BMW? Prefer for your brother. Say, I wish my brother would have a Ferrari. You want a house? Say, I wish my brother should have a mansion. This is what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is teaching us. And he also say, Imam Nawawi say, this brotherhood being referred here is not the brotherhood of Iman or in Islam, it's brotherhood in mankind. For every single descendant of Adam, not only for Muslims. These are the things, my brothers and sisters, if we truly implement in our lives, we will see the differences in the people who are around us. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was concerned for the poor and weak. Not because someone is poor or weak, then you can exploit them. No. And this surah is one of earlier surahs revealed in Makkah. أَرَأَيْتَ الَّذِي يُكَذِّبُ بِالدِّينِ. Have you seen the one who denies the day of judgment, the recompense, or religion? فَذَلِكَ الَّذِي يَدْعُ الْيَتِيمَ وَلَا يَخُدُّ عَلَى طَعَامِ الْمِسْكِينِ. Is the one who pushes away the orphans and he doesn't encourage the feeding of the poor. We need to reflect, my brothers and sisters, because these sort of teachings are the teachings which will make a difference in our lives and of those who are around us. Let's show, my brothers and sisters, to those who are non-Muslims, how great this deen is. We can't claim to be Muslims and we do not practice Islam. We have to live Islam. Islam is a way of life. It's not something you do one off. I'll only go on Friday and that's it. My job done. You have to be a Muslim all the time. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, taqullaha haqqa tuqatih, wa la tamutunna illa wa antum muslimun. Oh, you believe, be conscious of Allah. Conscious of Allah. And in the light of that, you have to make sure you will never die unless you are in the state of submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I have a question now. Who knows when they will die? We have to be Muslim all the time. We have to submit ourselves to the will of Allah all the time. It's not, I'm going to the masjid now and that's it. Whether it's at home, at work, on the road, I have to be a Muslim. My brothers and sisters, if we look into the Quran, we will find the following. The Quran and the Sunnah and the saying of the Sahaba, radiallahu anhum, that it was all revolving around love, brotherhood, forgiveness, rectification, removing differences, and bringing people together. This is what Islam is all about. It's not about dividing people. And with regard to this, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, show mercy to those on earth so that the one who is in the heavens will have mercy on you. Whoever is deprived of gentleness is deprived of all good. Brothers, can we move forward and make sure we squeeze to our left so that those who are coming, they can find some space for us. Abu Bakr, radiallahu anhu, he said, whoever wants to be shaded by Allah on Yawmul Qiyamah from the hellfire, then let him be merciful towards the believers. You have to have a tender heart to all the believers. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was traveling once with his companions. As we all know, they all loved him dearly. One of them was so close to him, to an extent where his camel and the camel of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they were squeezing, they were touching. So the food of the Sahabi was hurting the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he used his whip just to touch him, to let him know, look, actually you are hurting me. And the Sahabi realized that, he moved away. When they go back to Medina, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam called for that particular Sahabi. The Sahabi was worried. Is it because of what I did yesterday? So he got ready and he went to meet the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, yesterday you were hurting me, but I used my whip to alert you that you were hurting me. For that reason, I give you 80 sheep as a recompense, as a compensation. This is how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was. He was concerned. He didn't want to hurt anyone's feelings. We as Muslims, we are supposed to embody this behavior of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Ibn Umar radiallahu anhuma said, if I was to spend all night in prayer, all day fasting, and spend all of my wealth in giving charity, and then die without having any love in me for the people of obedience and any hate for the people of disobedience, then all of this won't mean anything. We need to reflect, my brothers and sisters. We as Muslims, what are we doing with regard to this religion? Because there is an issue here, and that issue is, are we the cause for people to stay away from Islam, or are we the cause for people to come into Islam? My brothers and sisters, whenever we see good, we should speak about it, because this is the way to increase goodness. And we should cover and conceal the sins of our brothers or our sisters. We should not publicize the faults of other people or start searching for people's faults. If you do that, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Allah is gonna look, he will search for your faults. Even if you were hiding yourself in a fortified building, can you hide from Allah? Allah will expose you. And this is not a way of bringing brotherhood. We should be humble, my brothers and sisters. When someone praises you, you say, it's a blessing from Allah. And someone abuses you, you should say, this perhaps it's because of the sin I committed. And instead of blaming that particular individual. When we see the elders, people who are older than us, we should honor them. How? By saying, he became a Muslim before me. And when we see the younger of us, we should say, mashallah, he's only 15 years, he's only been committing sins for 15 years, and I've been committing sins for 40 years. We should belittle ourselves instead of making ourselves big. My brothers and sisters, we really need to rethink about our notions and assumptions we hold about our beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What does it mean when we say we are on the sunnah, we are ahl al-sunnah wal jama'ah? What does it mean when we say we love the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? What does it mean? Thawman is one of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Once the Prophet, during Fajr time, he didn't see Thawman. So he asked the people around, where is Thawman today? He was informed Thawman was ill. So after the prayer, he said, let's go visit him. When they go to Thawman, he was talking to Thawman, asking what's the matter. Thawman said, I miss you in your presence. So you are sitting with someone now and you're already missing him. Because I know one day I will die, one day you will die. And you as a prophet, you're gonna be in the higher rank of paradise. And if I ever make it to paradise, I'll be at the lowest level. So it is this thought of you which made me sick. Can you imagine this? This thought of you, that one day I won't be seeing you anymore, it made me sick. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told Thawman, the one you will be resurrected on the Yawm al-Qiyamah with those whom you love. So don't worry, you're gonna be with me, inshallah. This is what, my brothers and sisters, if we were to say we love the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this is what we need to be doing. So, a lot of us, we claim to love the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Where are the signs to say we love the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? My brothers and sisters, as Muslims, we need to show Islam among ourselves. As a father in your house, as a mother in your house, as a son in your house, as a sister, as a brother in your house. We just need to live Islam in our communities, as families, as neighbors, and all of the abuses you see, believe you and me, it will be almost like it doesn't exist. Most of the times, people blame others. Most of the time, we do blame others, but not ourselves. I ask you a rhetorical question. For how many years you've been living in this country? Some of us 10 years, 15 years, 20 years, 30 years, 40 years. How many people have you guided into Islam? Or how many people they become Muslims because of you? If one or two, alhamdulillah. If not, then the fault lies in you. Not in them, but in you. And I'll justify my point. This is the story told by a witness, Sheikh Ismail Al-Farah. He was in Germany. In the masjid, just after the talk, they were sitting talking. Then someone came, a young boy, 13, 14, and knocked at the door. He said, who is a person in charge? Why do you want to see a person in charge? I want to become a Muslim. They were all surprised. Are you too young for this? Do you have parents? He said, actually, yes, it's not me who wants to be a Muslim, but my mom who is outside. So the woman was called in. She took her shahada. Then out of interest, they wanted to know, why did you want to become a Muslim? The woman said, I have three children. Two of them are girls, women, actually, they are all married now. And this is the youngest here, the boy. But I hardly see my daughters. They only come to visit me on occasions, maybe once or twice a year. And they all live in Germany. I have a neighbor whom is a Muslim. And I see that neighbor of mine every single day, her children with their grandchildren, they come and visit her. So I had to inquire. So I approached the children of that particular family. Not the parents, the children. I said, why is it you keep coming to visit your parents all the time? They answered, this is our religion. Islam demands us to make sure our parents, they are well looked after. I can never rest until I make sure that my mother and my father, they do not need anything. And this is what caused that particular woman to become a Muslim. To see how simple it is. She was not given any leaflet, No one was standing out there causing havoc, become Muslims or else your heads will be chopped. No. Let's just implement Islam in our lives. And my brothers and sisters, the rest will be history. However, my brothers and sisters, for this to happen, we need to know. We need to know. That which cannot be conceived, cannot be achieved. How can you implement something which you don't know? To start with, you have to know before you put that particular thing into practice. Very, very important. So when we talk of knowledge here, we mean the knowledge of who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is, first and foremost. Secondly, His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And thirdly, Islam in general. This is the most important thing, my brothers and sisters. This deen is not based on ignorance. This deen is based on knowledge. Those particular Muslims, the earlier Muslims, they were on top of this earth for more than 700 years, not on ignorance, it was on knowledge. They were in charge of the earth. Why? Because of knowing what they were supposed to be known. Any science you know of today, you look into history of it, the source was from the Muslims. My brothers and sisters, it's our responsibility as Muslims to make sure we, as Muslims, we put Islam into practice for those who do not know it, so that they can see what it is. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came to liberate us from our ignorance. He said, Islam is where faith, iman, and reason intersect. They come in harmony. You will never find any teaching of Islam contradicts your thinking, your common thinking. You will never find this unless you are an abnormal person. For anyone who submits to Allah, you will never find any teaching of Islam contradicts what you think of. He will say about ignorance, talb ilm farida ala kulli muslim. Seeking of knowledge is an obligation, is a must for every single Muslim. Man or a woman, you have to seek knowledge. And the knowledge here is referred to the knowledge of Allah, His Messenger, and Islam in general. First and foremost, this doesn't mean you can't be an engineer or a doctor. You can be whatever you want to be. However, the first knowledge which we need to know is who Allah is, and who was the Messenger, and what is Islam in general. Why is that? وَمَا خَلَقْتَ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. He did not create the mankind and jinkind except to live their lives according to the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala intended. And you can never do that if you do not know what Islam is, or what Allah is, or what the Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was. أَقُلُ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَاسْتَغْفِرُوا وَلِي وَلَكُمْ إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله مصطفى. أما بعد. Nowadays, my brothers and sisters, people abuse Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. However, the world is in a dire need of a personality like Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in order to solve the world problems. As Sir Bernard Shaw put it, had Muhammad been living with us, he was going to solve the world's problems as he was drinking a cup of coffee or tea. That's how easy for Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was going to be in sorting out the world's problems today. Bernard Shaw is a writer, I think he's Scottish, and a Muslim. He's a white guy. This is what he observed after looking into Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Therefore, my brothers and sisters, we need to let the world know who Muhammad is by applying and sharing his teachings in the world. We need to remember the teachings of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is that of Rahmah. He said, you will not enter paradise until you are compassionate or merciful. They say, we are all compassionate. The Sahaba said, we are all compassionate, we are merciful. However, within our narrow circles, with our friends, our family. He said, no, that's not the issue. وَلَكِنْ رَحْمَةَ النَّاسِ أَجْمَعِينَ. You have to be compassionate and merciful to all the people, not only the Muslims, to all the people. And this is the only way we can bring back the universality of Islam, the teachings of Islam, and the teachings of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and in turn, this will bring back his respect and honor in the world. And above all, my brothers and sisters, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam came as a liberator. And to this, he said, at the end of every day, everybody is a vendor, is a merchant of his own soul. We are all business people here, trading with our own souls. Some are going to liberate their souls, and some are going to bring about its demise. Now the question is, which one are we going to be? Are we going to be of those who liberate their souls by adhering to the teachings of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or are we going to be of those who bring about their wounds or their souls simply because we chose not to follow, the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Lastly, my brothers and sisters, let us bring our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam out of the masjid and take him to our families, into our way of life in general, as spouses, as children, as business people, and also to the environment, so that we can really have the comprehensive embodiment of the beautiful character of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us of those who love him and love us. May Allah make us of those who are not afraid of the blame of anyone who blames. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us of those who truly struggle in his path. And may Allah make us all of our efforts, accept all of our efforts in his deen, however many shortcomings there will be in there. May Allah accept all of our efforts and overlook those shortcomings.